our Sunday service. If you have your Bibles, get open to Psalms chapter 136. Psalms 136, a very simple psalm. We'll read this together, but I want you to reply to me His love and to His forever. Okay, Psalms chapter 136. We'll just read until verse 9, then we'll continue to verse 23. Anyway, if you don't have your Bibles, just reply His love and to His forever. Okay, let's read this. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His love endures forever.
To Him who alone does great wonders.
His love endures forever.
Who by His understanding made the heavens.
His love endures forever.
Who spread out the earth upon the waters.
His love endures forever.
Who made the great lights.
His love endures forever.
The sun to govern the day.
His love endures forever.
The moon and the stars to govern the night.
His love endures forever.
Verse 23, He remembered us in our lowest state.
His love endures forever.
And freed us from our enemies.
His love endures forever.
He gives food to every creature.
His love endures forever.
He gives thanks to the God of heaven.
His love endures forever.
Indeed, His love endures forever. So as we sing praises this morning, let's celebrate to Him who is faithful and true. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst the jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with harp, with the harp and the sound of singing. With trumpets and dust and drums. Shout for joy for the Lord. And shout for joy because He is good and He is now.
Thank you.
the condition of the heart regardless of the sound you make. And music is a gift. It is a blessing from the Lord. So to be able to sing without any hindrance, in awe of Him, to just praise and just to make known that the Lord is worthy. He is worthy, church. Amen. Is He worthy? When He is worthy, we just can't help but to sing with everything we have, with everything we are, because He is Lord over our lives. Whatever circumstance, whatever situation that we are in, He is Lord. And we are His song. So let us sing this.
tithing offerings, you come in front, give your tithing offerings. If you don't want to come in front, there's a box at the back. You can also come in there. Let's just continue to have to be in a manner of worship. The city is here, His presence is here. And we are here to declare that He is our God, He is our King, He is our Lord.
Here in your breath.
praise them. Psalm 90, chapter 95. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands form the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock of his spirit. Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we praise you and worship you for who you are, for your goodness, for your faithfulness, and for your grace and mercy. Father, we praise you for your faithful guidance. We praise and thank you for loving us and sending your one and only beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to save us and redeem us from eternal death. Father, thank you because you are our strength when we are weak. You are our hope when we are hopeless, and apart from you, we are nothing. Thank you, Father, for choosing us to be your children out of billions of charity. Thank you because you have loved us first. Forgive us, Father, for chasing after our own ambitions, our goals, and our own fortunes. We confess the old things of our heart that steer us off from your path of righteousness. May we always be reminded to live our lives in the path you have set before us. When we want to claim our achievements as our own, and our talents as abilities, and abilities we foster and accomplish ourselves. Please remind us and rebuke us, Father, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, that everything that we have in us, whether skills or talents, or possessions or resources, these are all from you and you alone. Help us, Mr. Father, to be good stewards for what you have blessed us with, and to share his blessings to others. Jesus, take our hands and guide our feet. Guide us as we make our choices in our lives. Guide our actions in victory and defeat. May our hearts grow more like yours each day, as we look around at the people you place in our lives to reach. Help us to love others in your honor through the talents and gifts you have given us. With all the distractions of everyday life, allow us to hear your call and follow you all. Help us to overcome the doubts, the pressures, and hardships that will challenge us as we walk behind you, Jesus. Help us, Father, to be intimate with you so we can know you and recognize when you call out to us. Mold us to be more like you so we can display your character in us, so people will see you in our lives by our words and our actions and the words of our hands. Thank you, Father, for everything that you do for us. This we pray in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We all say,
Amen. Before we take our seats, it's been a while. Can we go around and say hi to everyone around? If you are okay with it. If not, you can just say hi, wave hi. Right now, let's call on Brother Mark, who will be having a small announcement regarding our BBS. Thank you.
Truly, we have an amazing God. Good morning. And once again, this is Uncle Mac, and I am your campaign director for BTCC, Vacation Bible School. And indeed, time flies by so fast, and it's VBS season again. We are here to invite all the parents with elementary kids to register as soon as possible. So, at the present time, we know that social media is filled with deep fakes and false narratives about our planet, and about our identity, and about our God. This year's VBS theme is about the good planet that God created, as we have seen in our video presentation. Kids will learn the truth that it was God who created this awesome planet and that we all live in. It was God who created all the animals, the plants, the trees, and most especially us, human beings. We know that children are impressionable, and it is our commitment to expose them to the Word of God and its truth as much as possible. So help us spread the word and invite other kids to join. And this will be on July 4 to 8, 2023 at every 2 p.m. So save the date. Online registration begins now, or you may sign up after the worship service this morning. And we have provided a table at the chapel lobby. Registration is at 500 peso for early birds starting April 23, that is today, until June 4. From June 5 to June 30th, registration will be at 600 pesos. Thank you and God bless everyone.
Thank you, Brother Mark. Very fast. We are now having face-to-face BBS starting July. So if you know anyone, again, register at the back later after the service or online. Right now, let me just announce one more thing. Every Friday night, there's a worship service at our BCGC, or what we called before MGC. Here, it's led by the prayers, Bacolod Pastor's Prayer Fellowship. It's headed by Pastor Dave. It's every 6 p.m. Okay, every 6 p.m. We want to do something in Bacolod. And right now, we have this opportunity to have a worship service at our City Hall. Okay, every Friday night at 6 p.m. So if you're free, you can go and join them as well. And they have soaking time. They're preparing at 4 p.m. at the PCF Core. So if you're free, you can also be there at 4 p.m. And they go together at around 5:30 to prepare at the BCGC. And without further ado, our speaker today has been a speaker also previously. He's been helping our church as well. But I know some of you are new here, so let me introduce our speaker, his wife, Suzanne. They've been married for a long time, and they have two kids. I've heard that one is right now a pastor in Croatia, right? And the other one is here in Manila, and first-time grandparents during the pandemic, starting 2020. So they discussed that they haven't met their grandson until 3 months after, right? So, but praise the Lord, they were able to go, but there's a lot of testings. But now I think it's more freer, right? So let me introduce our speaker and welcome the couple, Pastor David Law and his wife, Susan.
God's people in a beautiful, beautiful sanctuary. You know, when I was coming in, immediately I thought of Petra. Some of you have been to Jordan. If you have been to Petra, you will understand what I mean. To be able to see Petra, Petra is, you know, the place where the people of old, They carve tombs and temples in the mountain. But for you to be able to see that, you have to walk, you know, a long way. However, once you saw it, you would, wow. And that's my feeling, you know, coming in and I see your beautiful chapel. And I thank the Lord. And I hope that I encourage you to be more prayerful so that the next time I come, I hope to see every new feeling. Now, okay. This morning, I want to think with you about a prayer that all of us have to be praying for. I believe that all of you pray. Is there anyone here who do not pray at all? I am sure there will be none. All of you, I believe, pray. Some of you probably pray once a day. Some of you probably pray three times a day, you know, just like a juice. Some of you probably pray five times a day, like the Muslims. Some of you pray constantly, you pray every day, you pray every hour. And in fact, I would like to believe that many of you are following the instructions of the Apostle Paul. You are praying without ceasing. Every moment, every time there's a need, you will be praying. It is very encouraging and it is very important that we pray, obviously. Even our Lord Jesus Christ, when He was on earth, He is the Son of God. But when He was on earth, the Bible said, He always, you know, drove Himself away from the crowd in order to pray. It is very important that we pray constantly, that we pray frequently. However, I want you to understand that more important than the frequency of our prayer, you know, how many times we pray, we need to be thinking about three things. One, who is the object of my prayer? Who am I praying to? Secondly, you need to be thinking about what is my attitude when we pray. If you pray constantly, but your attitude is wrong, then your prayer will not amount to much. And the third thing, which is what I want to emphasize today, is that we must be mindful of the content of our prayer. What do we pray for? Allow me now to second guess all of you, to read your mind. If you were like me, or most of the Christians that I know, I'm pretty sure that very often, probably every day, probably every moment, you will be praying about these things. First, you'll be praying for God's protection, especially in this COVID time. You will be praying for God's provisions, provision of food, provision of money, provision of a job. You will pray for blessing upon yourself, upon your family, upon your children, upon your loved ones. And I'm very sure that many of you, especially those of you who are getting older just like me, you'll always be praying for good health and strength. Am I right? Now, there's nothing wrong to be praying about these things because these are things that we truly need. However, I want you to understand that there is something that is more important than these things that we must be praying for if we are true followers of Jesus Christ. If you have your Bibles, kindly open your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 11 and 12. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 11 and 12. The Apostle Paul says, "To this end, we always pray for you, Thessalonians, that our God may make you worthy of His calling and may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by His power, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in Him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ." Take note of the content of Paul's prayer. Paul said, I pray for you always, that God may make you worthy of His calling. One of the most important prayers that we must be praying for as children of God is, Lord, make my life worthy of your calling. Now, let me ask you an honest question. How many of you have prayed this prayer before? Please raise your hand. Very good. I see some. But the great majority, I don't see you raising your hand. I want to encourage you. We must be praying this prayer. Lord, make my life worthy of your calling. Or, make my life worthy of the gospel. That is how the Bible puts it in another way. So this morning, we are going to think about this. We are going to think about this prayer with the end of hoping that we will be encouraged to pray that prayer constantly. Now, before we study our passage today, allow me to give you a background of 2 Thessalonians. Why did Paul write the letter or the epistle of 2 Thessalonians? Now, the Apostle Paul wrote this letter for these reasons, to encourage the Thessalonian Christians as well, you know, as to strengthen them. You see, at that time, the Thessalonian believers, they were facing two major obstacles, two major problems. So that is why Paul had to write to strengthen and to encourage them. Number one, at that time, there were false teachers who were misrepresenting Paul. These false teachers were not just simply teaching false doctrines, but they were so bold that they went to Thessalonica and say, we are from Paul. The Apostle Paul sent us here. Not only that, they were so bold, they even presented a fake letter, saying this letter is from the Apostle Paul. So fake news, hindi ba ngayon? Dati pa may fake news na. So these people, they presented fake letters purportedly to be coming from the Apostle Paul. And in that letter, they were saying, the Lord Jesus Christ had already come. The day of the Lord has already come. We are now living in the tribulation time. So, you know, you don't have to share the gospel anymore. You don't have to do anything anymore. You know, the Lord has come. So, Paul had to write this letter to encourage them, to strengthen them. Otherwise, they would be deceived. Now, there's a second reason why Paul wrote this letter. Because at that time, there was strong opposition. There was great persecution among the Christians. The Christians, they were persecuted not only by their neighbors, by the Jews, but they were also persecuted by the Romans. They were persecuted, you know, by the pagans, by the unbelievers of those days. So Paul had to write them. And particularly, if you have read 2 Thessalonians, he was telling them, the day of the Lord has not yet arrived, but it will come very soon. Jesus Christ is coming very soon. Because of that, today, although there is persecution, although life is extremely difficult, be faithful. Fix your eyes on the second coming of the Lord and keep on being faithful. So this is the context. This is the background of 2 Thessalonians. Now we come to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 11 and 12, the passage that we are trying to understand. Now, at that time, Paul was very concerned about the Christians, obviously, because there were false teachers, because there were persecutions. So out of his love and his concern, he wrote the passage. And I want you to pay attention. Paul said, I always pray for you. If you go to the Greek Bible, the word always is pantote. Pantote means all the time. Pantote means, you know, every now and then. Pantote will also mean whenever, wherever possible. I am praying for you. I know that some of you, you are parents. Some of you are grandparents, you know, just like me. Whenever we think of our children, of our grandchildren, you know, every so often, we would be praying for them. If you are a, you know, godly and loving parent and grandparent, I'm sure when you think of your children and their problems and the things that they're facing, every now and then you will be praying for them. Tama na? Yes. Paul, you know, he was the spiritual father of the believers at that time. So every now and then he would be praying for them. He would always be praying for them. I want you to understand that. Not only that, Paul was praying along with Timothy and Silas. They were his partners. That is why the Bible said, we always pray for you. Paul did not say, I always pray for you, but we always pray for you. Because Paul understands that the problem that they were facing, you know, were extremely difficult, challenging, and important. Therefore, together as a team, the team of pastors, they prayed for the Thessalonians. And then thirdly, I want you to pay attention. They prayed, or Paul prayed, that God would enable them, that God would empower them, that God would give them the ability, the grace, to live a life that is worthy of their calling. Take note. Paul did not say, we always pray for your deliverance and protection. Obviously, they need deliverance, they need protection. And I'm sure that Paul and his team, every now and then, also pray for that. But they always pray. There was something that they always pray for, and that is that they would live a life that is worthy of their calling. Paul did not simply pray for strength, for perseverance, but Paul particularly prayed that they would live a life worthy of their calling. So right now, I want to ask you three questions, and I want you to be thinking. I don't want you to just sit there and listen to me, especially in this warm weather. It's so easy to fall asleep. So I want you to think. Question number one. Be honest, have you prayed this prayer for yourself? Earlier, I had already asked a question and a few of you have raised your hands. But right now, I want you to be thinking about this again. Have I prayed this prayer? Second question. If you have been praying this prayer, are you always praying? Or do you just pray, you know, 10 years ago, when you accepted the Lord, you know, the first time, Lord, make my life worthy of your calling. And after that, ever since then, you have not been praying that. How often are you praying? For those of you who have never prayed this prayer before, the question would be, why? Why am I not praying this prayer? And then there's this third question that I want to challenge. Those of you who are older, those of you who are disciples, those of you who are parents, question, have you or do you pray this same prayer for your children, for your grandchildren, for the people that you are discipling? I know that this is a school. Some of you may be teachers. Let me ask you, teachers, are you praying for your students? Are you praying this prayer for your students? You know, this is a very important prayer. That is why, despite the fact that the Thessalonians, they need protection, they need, you know, the Lord's guidance and all these things, Paul did not focus his prayer on those things. But Paul focused his prayer on the life that they are living. I have to admit, my wife and I, we often pray this prayer for our children. In our grandson, our favorite grandson, the only one. However, I have to admit, we do not pray for them in this manner always. Every once in a while, you know, we will pray, but not always. So, the message of Paul to you is also Paul's message to me and to us. We have to be praying constantly for ourselves, for our children, for our loved ones, for the young people of your church, for the students of this school, that each one of us will live a life that is worthy of the calling of God. I'm sure all of you remember Job of the Old Testament. Now, when we think of Job, we only think of his sufferings. However, I want you to remember the Bible described Job as a righteous man. And one of the reasons why he was called a righteous man, was because he was so concerned about his own righteousness and about the righteousness of his children. And in this passage, I don't know if you can read it. Let me read it for you. Job chapter 1, verse 4 and 5. This is another thing. These two verses says, his sons used to go and hold a feast in the house of each one on his day, probably on the birthday or whatever, anniversary, monthsary, or whatever. You know, they had parties in their individual homes. And they would send and invite their three sisters to come and eat and drink with them. They are a big, loving family, always eating together. Probably they have Chinese blood, you know, keep on eating. So they were always eating. However, the next verse says, and when the days of the feast, by the way, in those times when they have weddings, when they have birthdays, the party is not just 1 hour, it's not just one day, it is always, you know, several days. So when the days of the feast had run their course, Bible said, Job would send for his sons, and he would consecrate them, and he would rise early in the morning, offer burnt offerings according to the number of each one of them, the number of them all. For Job said, pay attention, this righteous man said, it may be that my children have sinned. I don't know. It may be that they have sinned or they have cursed God in their heart. Thus, Job did continually, just like the Apostle Paul. Pantope. Always. He always prayed that his children would live a life worthy of God's grace in their lives. So again, let this be a challenge to us and to all of you. Pray always this prayer. Lord, make me worthy, you know, of my calling. Enable me to live a life that is worthy of the gospel. Pray that prayer also for your children, for your loved ones, for the people that you're leading, for the people that you are winning for the Lord. Now, some of you, I believe, will have this question. Okay, also, what is that calling all about? What are we called to? Now, if you look at the context of the passage, you will come to realize that Paul was actually talking about four kinds of calling. There were four kinds of calling that Paul was referring to. The first call, which is the most important, the most obvious, is the call to salvation. All of us, each one of us, we are now in Christ because God called us. That's why Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 says, we are saved by grace through faith. So God, in His grace, called us. We are not worthy. We are sinners. You know, we live in darkness. We follow Satan. But God, in His grace, in His love, He called us. He saved us. We are unworthy. But He sent His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross. I love this. The cross is just here to remind us of the great sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. He paid the great price. Salvation is free for us. All we need to do is believe, acknowledge that we are sinners, believe and accept the salvation that Jesus Christ has provided. It's free. However, I want you to understand, it takes the Lord Jesus Christ a great deal. He paid a great price in order to save you. So Paul is saying, remember, you're called to salvation, to the blessings that come with it, but a great price has been paid. So live a life that is worthy of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Now, in order for you to understand this better, I want you to imagine, especially the ladies, you probably relate to this more. Imagine that you come from a, let's say, a simple family, a middle-class family. Not so rich, not entirely poor, a hard-working family. And your husband is a hard worker. And because your husband is a hard worker and he loves you very much, he knows that next year you're going to celebrate your 40th birthday or 30th birthday. So he said, you know, I love my wife, I'm going to give him, I'll give her a beautiful gift. Without your knowing, he worked double job, he saved a lot of money. Come next year, your birthday, ta-da! He has a gift for you. When you unwrap the wrapper, lo and behold, it's a Louis Vuitton bag. Wow. For your information, you know, a Louis Vuitton bag would cost anywhere from $1,000 to $4,000. I was told there are two, I don't have any, my wife don't have any Louis Vuitton, I can't afford to give her that. But I was told that there are two kinds of Louis Vuitton bags. The first type is the cheaper one, and it's made of nylon. But still, a nylon Louis Vuitton bag would cost anywhere from $1,000 to $2,000. It depends on the dollars. However, the high-end one, made of leather, it would cost anywhere from $2,000 to $4,000. So imagine your husband on your 40th birthday. He gives you a $4,000 bag. Now let me ask you this question. When you have that bag, will you bring this bag to the market? Will you put, you know, the fish, you know, the gulay, the bagoong in your bag? Will you? Obviously not. When you go out and when you come home, I'm very sure you'll not just throw it on the side. You'll not just leave it on the cardboard. I'm very sure that you will go in, probably, you know, lock it under key. Why? This is an expensive bag. And my husband paid a great price in order for me to have this bag out of his love for me. He took second job without my knowing. He saved his money, and now I have this Louis Vuitton bag. By the way, the Louis Vuitton bag I'm talking about is not those in AAA. Yeah, this is the real one. So this is what Paul was saying. Hey, all of you, live a life worthy of your calling. You're called to salvation, but that salvation is not free. It's free for us, but the Lord paid a great price out of His love, out of His sacrifice. Now you have salvation. So live a life that is worthy of that. Treasure it, appreciate it. You know, live with gratitude out of what the Lord has done for you. Now there's a second meaning. When Paul said live a life that is worthy of your calling, the calling that he was referring to was the call to suffering. Now I can see some of your faces changing. When I say we are called to salvation, many of you are smiling. But when I say we are called to suffering, your countenance changes. Just like Cain, you know, when he saw that God accepted the offering of Abel, his countenance changed. Many of us, we don't understand, and we cannot agree, and we cannot accept the fact that we are called to suffering. That is why the prosperity preachers, they're very rich, they are very successful in what they are doing, because they preach that if you believe in Jesus Christ, you know, everything is free, you know, you will be rich, you will be prosperous. There's no such thing as suffering. In fact, you will not get sick. But let me tell you, that is not the truth. That is, in fact, farthest from the truth. We are called to suffering. And the Apostle Paul, he understood that. In fact, he saw with his two own eyes and from his own experience that being a Christian will entail much, much suffering. The Thessalonians, they were suffering a great deal. So that is why Paul said, be worthy of that calling. Not everyone is called to suffer for Christ. But you are privileged to suffer for Christ. Therefore, live a life that is worthy of that calling. In other words, he's saying, as you suffer for him, you must suffer with integrity, with Christ-like character. Just like our Lord Jesus Christ, when he was brought to the cross, the Bible said he was silent like a lamb that was brought to the slaughterhouse. He was gentle. He was kind. And that is what we are to do. Yes, we will suffer. In case some of you are still not convinced, or in case you are saying, you're thinking that, you know, Bokso is just threatening us. I am not. Look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 29. Paul said, for it has been granted to you that for the sake of Christ, you should not only believe in him, but should also suffer for his sake. We are called not just to believe in him, but we are called to suffer for his sake. So whether you know it or not, whether you like it or not, I'm sorry, this is the truth. Suffering for Christ is part and parcel of our calling. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. What steps? The steps of suffering. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Let me just pause for a moment and tell you something very honest from the heart. If you have been a Christian for a number of years or a number of months, and up to this day, you have never been persecuted or laughed at or being slandered, you know, because you are a Christian. In other words, if you have never suffered for your faith, you better watch out. It's either you have a fake faith, you do not really belong to Christ, or you have been compromising with your faith. You have been living on the edge, very close, you know, to the world. Because if we are truly godly, we will be suffering for Christ. Very simple. We are of the light, the world, we are of the darkness. We are called to be holy, a royal people, holy priesthood. But they are sinful, they are evil. So obviously, you know, we cannot, they cannot live with us in as much as we should not be able to live with them. So if you are able to live with them, you know, and live, you know, happily ever after, you better watch out. Something might be wrong with your faith, because each one of us, we are supposed to be suffering. However, when we suffer, we must be just like Christ, with Christ-like character. Corrie ten Boom, some years ago, he was ministering in a small African town. African nation. And 2 weeks before she came, she arrived in that African country. That country was overtaken by a government that was hostile to the Christians. In fact, that very same week, the government was systematically and secretly killing Christians. So when Corrie ten Boom came to this church, small church, everybody was so fearful, you know, sadness and fear were edged on their faces. They were very much afraid. And the Holy Spirit asked Corrie ten Boom to read a passage of the Bible to them. And she read 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 to 14 in the Phillips translation. And now, dear friends of mine, I beg you not to be unduly alarmed at the fiery ordeals which come to test your faith, as though this were some abnormal experience. You should be glad, because it means that you are called to share Christ's suffering. One day, when he shows himself in full splendor to men, you will be filled with the most tremendous joy. If you are reproached for being the followers of Christ, that is a great privilege, for you can be sure that God's Spirit of glory is resting upon you. Brothers and sisters, let me remind you, I know you don't like to be reminded of this, but we are called to suffer. And I pray that we will live a life that is worthy of that calling. That we suffer, not just endure suffering, but we suffer joyfully, because we know that we are partaking in the suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ, he was oppressed, afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers, he was silent. He did not open his mouth. May the Lord help us. Suffering this manner is not easy, but this is our calling. Now, when Paul prayed that they would live a life that is worthy of their calling, he was also referring to the call to service, the call to faithful service, the call to faithful service. Now, I want you to understand again, I want to remind you again, that at that time, there were false teachers. Now, these false teachers, here was the worry of Paul. These false teachers, they were not simply teaching false doctrines, but they were being false examples. What they were teaching, you know, was false, but their lives, particularly the way they served the Lord, you know, was all farce. It's all fake. That is why they don't have any qualms about breaking the law of God, about preaching a false gospel, you know, because they have been unfaithful. And that was the fear of Paul. And Paul was reminding them, hey, you are called to serve the Lord. By the way, in the Bible, the word service and the word worship is synonymous. So when we are called to serve the Lord in whatever way, it is actually our worship of God. When you are coming here to worship the Lord, that actually is a form of service to God. So whether in worship, whether in service, we must be faithful. Apollo Kibuloy, all of you know him. I hope you're not listening to him. I hope you're not following him. I turned about and when I hear of his name, I am so ashamed. Apollo Kibuloy, for your information, he used to be a pastor of a sound fundamental evangelical church. Felix Manalo, we also know him. Founder of Iglesia Ni Cristo. He also used to be a pastor, a worker, you know, in a sound fundamental Protestant church. But why do these people now go astray? And why are they leading so many astray? It's all because in small things they were unfaithful. So in their small unfaithfulness, eventually they became unfaithful in bigger things and bigger things and bigger things. The Bible gives us that principle. If you are faithful in small things, you'll be faithful in big things. So the application is, if you are unfaithful in small things, you will also be unfaithful in bigger things. DBBS is coming around. I know that some of you will be called, you know, to serve as teachers and staff, helpers. Be faithful. Even if that day comes and in your class you have only one student, be faithful. My wife and I, we often go to India. And let me tell you, when we go to India, we are so amazed because many of these churches, we have to walk for miles. In a small village, few people, but our missionaries are faithfully serving the Lord. It's not easy to be a missionary, to be a pastor, to share the gospel in India. But they are faithful to me. Brothers and sisters, I don't know what your calling or the ministry that Lord has called you to do. Your ministry may be in the church. Your ministry may be in the school. Your ministry may be in the workplace. Some of you may be called, you know, to minister, to serve the Lord, you know, in your house. To be a testament, to be a witness to your unbelieving relatives. Be faithful. Be faithful. Because that is our calling. The call to faithful service. I love what Billy Graham once said. He said, the Holy Spirit gives liberty to the Christian, direction to the worker, discernment to the teacher, power to the Word of God, and fruit to faithful service. The Holy Spirit will give fruit to faithful service. May the Lord help us. This is our calling. We have to be faithful in whatever God has called us to do. The last call that Paul was referring to is the call to sanctification. In fact, we can say it is a call to glorification. Because you have to remember one day, very soon, we are going to meet the Lord and we are going to be glorified with Him. Today we are studying 2 Thessalonians in chapter 1 verse 11. However, if you read chapter 1 verse 10 and the preceding verses, you will discover that Paul was talking about this thing. Paul was saying, those people who are unfaithful, the false teachers, the false Christians, one day, God will punish them. So don't follow them. Paul was encouraging them in this way. But Paul was saying, as for you, be faithful because one day you are going to be glorified with Christ. One day you're going to be glorified with Christ. Therefore, in verse 11, he said, towards this end, we pray for you. towards the end of glorification, towards the end of sanctification, we pray for you. So today, we have to remember we are called to live holy lives, to glorify the Lord with our lives today. Because one day, we are going to live with Christ and we are going, you know, to glorify Him. Tamlong. Hindi siya tamlong. Tamlong is a theologian. He's a professor in a seminary. One day on a plane, he met someone, a stranger. So he became friends with this person and they began to talk about their families. Initially, they just shared some information and then some pictures, you know, on their iPhones. But then this guy revealed something to Tang. And he was amazed, he was shocked. The person said, you know, I actually have another son, not you. You don't see the picture of my son. This son, when he was a teenager, he met an accident. He became a vegetable. And for the last 30 years, mind you, 30 years, he lived in the hospice. And then this guy told Tom, after 30 years, my wife and I have ceased to love our son. My wife and I have ceased to love our son. Because whenever we go, he does not respond. He's a vegetable. So it's so hard to love someone that is not responding. So he said, after 30 years, we have lost our love for our son. However, the man said, one day, when we went back to visit our son, we saw a person, a stranger that we don't know. That person was talking to our son. He was reading the Word of God from the book of Psalms to my son. And this man confessed, when I saw this person reading the Bible to my son, I said in my mind, you're crazy. He doesn't know what you're talking about. He cannot, you know, he doesn't understand what you're doing. But then the man went on to hold the hand of the son and to pray with him. And he became very angry and said, you idiot. Don't you know he's a vegetable? Why are you praying to him for him? Why are you reading the Bible to him? Just then he said, the Holy Spirit convicted him. And the Holy Spirit told him, that person is looking at your son from the perspective of eternity. He knows that your son one day, very soon, will be glorified. When Jesus Christ returns, your son, you know, will have a new body, a glorified body. And because of that, out of that perspective, even today, he ministers to your son and he prays for your son because he knows that this is a child of God. One day, he's going to be glorified. Brothers and sisters, whether you know this or not, whether you accept this or not, you and I, we are going to be glorified. Even if we think we are unworthy, obviously, not one of us is worthy. I cannot claim that I'm worthy to be glorified. But that is the promise. One day, we are going to be glorified when Jesus Christ comes. Therefore, today, even now, we have to live a life of sanctification because that is our calling. That is our calling. And so today, I end my message with a challenge that I had earlier mentioned. Starting now and always pray this prayer. Lord, enable me to live a life that is worthy of your calling. Lord, enable my children enable my nephews, my nieces, my loved ones, my students, my disciples, enable them to live a life that is worthy of your calling. If you pray that prayer for yourself and for your loved ones, let me tell you, you are praying the best prayer of all. This prayer is more important than praying for protection, praying for provisions, praying for all those blessings. Live a life. Lord, enable us to live a life that is worthy of your calling. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You love us so much. We are so unworthy. Even now, after you have saved us, we continue to sin. And every so often, we even forsake you, disobey you, disregard you, but yet you continue to love us. Father, I pray that beginning today, you will enable us to live a life that is worthy of our calling, a calling to salvation, a calling to service, a calling to sanctification. Father, I pray that you will enable us to live a life that is separate, that is different, and I want to glorify you. I pray also for the next generation, for our children, for those who come behind us. When we are done, I pray that they will continue in the faith, that they will continue to glorify you, that they will continue to propagate the gospel and be a witness for you. This is our sincere and humble prayer in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Well, thank you, Boksu, for praying us that we need to live our lives worthy for His calling. Let me just invite the prayer team. Can you all stand up, prayer team? And for those who want somebody to pray for them, I know it's not easy, but for those who want someone to pray for them, you can approach these people. They're standing after our prayer, after our singing. You can approach them, they will pray for you. Okay? And I also see a lot of new faces. Welcome. I hope that you can join us every Sunday. So right now, we all stand and then sing this song. And as we sing this song, again, just want to remind everyone, what is the Lord teaching us today? What is the Holy Spirit speaking to us right now? Our life is a continuous journey to what day we will be Him. So we don't stop living, we don't stop being who we are. We continue to keep on growing, knowing Him and loving Him and leading people more than Him. So as we sing this song, let's talk to the Holy Spirit. What are you teaching me and how I can change my life to be the person you want me to be?
Worthy of every song we can ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
She's the only one.
need your grace not just to save us from the clutches and fires of hell, but we need your grace to save us from all wickedness today. We need your grace so that we will be able to live a life that is worthy of the gospel of your calling. Dismiss us now with your grace, with your mercy, with your power, with your presence, wherever we go. Help us truly to live a life that is worthy of our calling until we bring the Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.